Man, if you need to take a break at any time, you know, you just say
it. Okay.
Yeah, we'll stop the video and start it back. Good morning, Earl Lewis. Thank you for coming to Emory, Atlanta, Georgia, for the Veterans History Project. I'm Dr. Rashanice Candy Tate with the Association for the Study of African American Life and History. And I'm here with
Robert Pineau.
Who's with
Atlanta Metropolitan State College.
All right. And we're going to be conducting the interview today for you.
Okay.
And did I say the date? Today is, what is today? Today is Thursday, June 25th, 2015, and we're in Atlanta, Georgia. I'm Dr. Rashanice Candy Tate with the Association for the Study of African American Life and History, and I'm here with
Robert Pineau of Atlanta Metropolitan State College.
And we're interviewing Mr. Earl Perry. With about the veterans experience.
Yes.
So, Robert, take it away.
Okay. Where and when were you born?
I was born May 5th, 1958 in Washington, D.C.
Who were your parents and what were their occupations?
My mother was Pearl Doggin and my father was Samuel Perry. My mother was worked as a housekeeper for a congressman, and I really didn't have a relationship with my father.
Can you tell us who the congressman
was? I'm not sure. Okay. What is Mr. White, I believe his name was Mr. White.
Who are your siblings? And any of them serve in the military?
Yeah, my siblings? Yes, my sister Donna Washington served in the Navy, and my brother Harold Doggin served in the Navy, and my deceased brother Charles Wallace served a short tour in the Army, United States Army.
And where are you in the?
I'm number 4 out of 11.
What were you doing before you entered the service?
Well, my mother had 11 children, so she couldn't raise all of us. And some good people raised me and a brother down in Halifax County, Virginia. We grew up on a farm. they had a lot of work on the farm. And I was looking for a way to get away. So I had a friend join the Marine Corps, and when he joined, he came back and he said, you could do this. And I went and saw the recruiter, and the recruiter picked me up. I'll never forget the day that he picked me up. And he picked me up, he gave me some information to look over, said we would be taking his test. And he picked up about 6 people, and everybody, when he dropped us off, he said, you fail, you're gonna have to do it again. And I was the last person he dropped off. He said, I passed, and I would have to go to the physical. So I was in Richmond doing the physical maybe a few weeks later.
So really your reason for enlisting was just, you know, you wanted something new?
I wanted something different. I didn't want to be stuck there being on a farm and be a product of what I saw the people were in my surroundings growing up. I wanted to venture out and do other things in life.
And I want, before we move on, the test. So you passed the test.
Yes, so, I did.
Kind of tell us about what was. Do you remember what was on the test?
They had a lot of questions. It was general knowledge. It was general math, general English. Mm-hmm. It was questions like if this happened and this happened, how would you do this or something? It was questions like that. So it was just general knowledge. And mm-hmm. I don't test good. I'm not a good test person, but I can always pass.
Okay.
So I'm always confident in any test that I take.
So you were, would you call yourself a good student?
I'm not gonna say I was a good student. I wasn't really smart, and I'm a little undisciplined at times, so the Marine Corps was kind of made for me.
Okay. Well, I'm not going to steal his thunder. I'm going to let him go back to his question.
Okay.
What was your family's reaction to you enlisting?
Everybody was kind of, when I first joined the Marine Corps, he's going in the Marines. You know, they weren't confident in him because nobody else in my family had ever been. And they didn't think maybe I wouldn't make it. But I proved them wrong.
When was the exact day, or if you remember, that you left for training camp?
I'm not sure the exact date that I left, but I know it was like in August or September in 77.
Why'd you pick the Marines over any other branch?
Like I said, it was really not what I picked. My friend just went to basic training and came back and said, you could do this. And when I saw him with his uniform and I knew how me and him, well, we ran track together, I said, yeah, I could do this. So,
how did you get down to training camp?
That's an experience you'll never forget. I went to my recruiter and he said, I want to give you a good last meal before you go. So he took us to Wendy's and got us one of those triple burgers. And he said, now enjoy it and I'll see you when you get back. And we got on a bus in the little local town, Danville, Virginia, and we started traveling. And as we were traveling, you know, it was regular people on the bus, but the closer we got to Charleston, South Carolina, it was all other young guys going into the Marine Corps too. And then you start talking, then once you get to Charleston, it's all guys that's going to the Marine Corps. So it was a bus ride. But the thing about it is, when you get to Charleston, the young Marines that's already there, they get on the bus with you and hollering at you and carrying on. And this is like 11, 12 at night. And you know, you want to do what they're telling you to do. But they start out coming at you. They try to pull that attitude out you from the start. So it's an experience. And anybody ever went through it will never forget it.
What was your first day of training camp like?
My first day of training camp, it was a scary day. It was a very scary day. Like I said, when we got to the bus, we got off, people were hollering at you to get on the footprints. They had little yellow footprints, like you're standing at attention. And then they got you up early, you went to sleep, maybe got up a couple of hours later. They had you, and they try to get you in a formation, but they show you how undisciplined you were. You were a mob, and everybody looked at you and gritted on you and say, you know, you're undisciplined. And you had the long hair. They took you to breakfast, then they took you and they cut all your hair, gave you a bald head. Then they took you and gave you some uniforms, and then they took you all around and gave you all of the necessities you want, and then, you know, they took you to meet your drill instructors and who was gonna groom you into becoming a Marine.
What was training camp like once you actually got, you know, a few weeks in and started getting used to it?
Well, it was good. It was challenging. Being a country boy, I could do all the physical stuff. I was a young man when I went in, but they enhanced it and made me a better man. It teaches you, and I think it's one of the greatest things that could happen to young people is to go and get some, it gives you structure, it teaches you discipline, it teaches you how to pay attention, it teaches you initiative. The service is the best thing that ever happened to me in my life.
How old were you when you actually went?
I was 19 when I joined the Marine Corps. I wasn't doing nothing at home and I was messing up, so I needed to go do something, and I did something.
How were your instructors? What were they like?
They were difficult. They were hard. The drill instructors, they had different ones. They taught you different things, and but we had some that were jokesters, but they were all tough. They were tough and they taught you tough. And I think they instilled that in me in my life of being tough and putting in hard work and you see the results. So it was, they were tough, but they were fair.
Did you receive any type of specialized training?
I did. When I was in the Marine Corps, after basic training and after I stayed for 3 years, I re-enlisted as a into recon. And while I was in recon, I trained with the Navy SEALs and I went to jump school and I was a rigger. I packed parachutes for the people to jump.
Was there any special instructor that you recall more than any other one?
Not really. No, one was about it, so all of them were equal. The senior drill instructor was a little more tougher. He was a little more lenient, but the younger drill instructors were probably trying to get his position, and they had to come at us a little harder, but it really worked out. It was fine.
Do you remember his name?
Don't know.
How did you adapt to military life, like the physical, the food, the social life?
It was easy to adapt to because I think I went there with a little discipline anyway. So if you have some discipline, they don't have to work as hard with you. I knew what was required of me. And I didn't want to go back to the farm, so I wanted to succeed in things in life. When you want something, you have to want to succeed. So I wanted to succeed.
What did you think about military life before you went in? Like, what was it to you on the outside looking in?
People always had negative things. You know, you go in there and they had like you gonna eat out of a can or something and. You know, you don't perceive it as, and like now it's more of a apartment life, but it was, I didn't look at it in a bad way, and I looked at it, it ended up being a good thing.
How would you want to answer this question? I didn't know if you wanted to.
Oh, I didn't know you wanted to work. You were speaking of the drill sergeant, mm-hmm. and then, but you spoke about, you know, how it built you. Mm-hmm. Did they instill any teamwork into you?
Of course. Everything we did was involved in teamwork. Everything you did, it was a team. When you work together, when we go out there and we had to do different positions for our fire teams, and they teach you how to keep spacing and different things. It was all about teamwork. Mm-hmm. Everything that we did was, and our team helped another team. So it was all about teamwork, and it wasn't about being an individual. It was about being a team, and that's the way the Marine Corps is built. They built on helping each other.
But you don't start out that way.
No.
So you said, you coming from a farm, having the discipline. So that person that wasn't as disciplined as you, how did you help them, or how did the group help the weakest link?
We would see somebody that maybe couldn't do as things as good as we could, or maybe it wasn't as athletic, and we had to reassure them, you could do this. I saw guys when we had different drills to do. That you had to go across ropes real fast and hold on and do things, and it wasn't hard to do, but some people had never did this in their life, and you had to help them out. You had to reassure them that they can do it, and I help people like that now in my life and my job, and to tell them that they can do a good job and let them know. And when you get people to come back after you done reassured them and you see that they do a good job, it feels good to know that you help somebody to succeed.
Where did you serve?
I started out in Parris Island, South Carolina in basic training, and then I left Parris Island, came home for about 30 days and went to Camp Pendleton, California, to infantry training school. And when I left Camp Infantry Training School, I was fortunate. I got barracks duty in the Philippines. And I stayed over there for 2.5 years, and I didn't want to leave there. It was a nice little port. And and then I left there and came back to Camp Lejeune, North Carolina. Went on 3 Mediterranean cruises. Well, that's when I experienced Beirut and Grenada. And I got out, and I also, like I said, I went to jump school and rigger school. And I got out of the Marine Corps in Jacksonville, North Carolina. And it was a good 6.5 years that I did.
How was South Carolina different from D.C.? Like, was there any culture shock?
Oh, it wasn't a major culture shock. They had these things called sand fleas. And they bite. And they're real little, and they get in your head and your neck and all of these places, and they want you to stand at attention, and you sitting there fighting to be at attention while these bugs biting you. So and then if you reach up like that, a hit or something, they would sometime get you, and you would have to do push up, but sometime you had to take it. And that was tough, but we got used to it.
Where did you serve abroad first?
Well, I first served abroad was in the Philippines at barracks duty. I was at the Subic Bay, the Philippines. It was a naval base, and what we did there, I was in B Company, and what we did was security for the ammo bunkers. They had bunkers when they had Vietnam. The ammo bunkers was what they would get ammo to go on the ships and the airplanes and all of that. So these bunkers were built out in the jungle inside of a fence, and it was we had to do security. We had to do like Roman guard 24 hours because the locals would break in and they would steal the ammo. So, and I mean, it was under lock and key, but they would steal old shell casings and different things. And then we had to do patrols around it. So it was, that was the first place. And it was a good little place, Philippines.
You need to do it for all of them, or just mm-hmm. Okay, I'm gonna backtrack a little bit. What was the, if you know the dates for being in South Carolina in your training camp?
I think it went like in August or September to maybe November. It was about 3 months, so I think it was August, and I think I went home around Christmas.
What year?
77.
Okay, so just mostly year, if you remember.
Okay.
Months, that's fine. Right. But kind of years.
In 77, and mm-hmm. then in 78, I went to infantry training school in Camp Pendleton, North Carolina. And then, in also right after I finished that, completed that, that's when I went to the Philippines in 78. And I stayed there 79 and 80. And I probably left there in 80, 81.
What was the Philippines like?
It was beautiful. It was a beautiful, the scenery, the island life, tropical, being in the jungle. You get to see, you see things that you see on TV. You see the monkeys walking around freely and a different thing. So it was a different place, different culture. And once you go to different places, you get to see how other people live and how blessed you really are, because everybody don't have air conditioning and running water. So it's an experience.
Where did you go after you left the Philippines?
After the Philippines, I came home. And back in, that was in 80, maybe 81, and I came back home, and then I went to Camp Lejeune, North Carolina, to an infantry training. Went to an infantry 2-8, 2nd Battalion, 8th Marines, and from there, I left and went on my first Mediterranean cruise right after I got there. But that was okay too.
So that was it. Wasn't a cruise, like a casual cruise.
Oh no, it wasn't. It was nothing like that. It was a ship. The quarters were really tight. It wasn't a real comfortable lifestyle. You had people that were around. You slept in bunks that maybe you had this much space, and maybe that wide. And it was five of them stacked up. And you had a little locker. You didn't have a lot of room to do a lot of stuff, but you made it work. It was something else being on the ship and being out there in that rough water, and being on the ship for days and weeks. When you first go out in the Mediterranean and you leaving and you see the land, and then you be gone, you don't see land. And then after a while, you don't see land. And you don't see land for a month. And you start seeing mirages. You think it's land, but it's not. And then you're out there, and then you get to see how much water there is in the world. And then to run into a storm out there, and you're on a big ship. And on this big ship, the big ship rocks. That water will rock that ship. They have to tie everything down. And you in the bed, your bed has a little bar on the side about that high. So it keeps you, but when you're sleeping, everything is moving. Just like when you're eating, when you wake up the next day, the ship. And some ships are moved, don't roll as much as others. They have a ship I was on once, a LST. It's a flat bottom ship. It can come right up to the shore, and it will come up to let amphibious off and let troops off. It can come right up to the shore. But the ship that was on, the LPH, to carry helicopters, it doesn't come up there, so it wasn't as bad. Now, the difference in the ships, if you're on a smaller ship, the food is better, the lines are not as long, but the ride is a little rougher. On the big ships, the food is not as good. The lines are extra long. You have to take showers. When you take a shower, you cut the shower on, wet your body up, cut the shower off, soap your body up, cut the shower back on, and rinse off, and cut the water off. You have to preserve water because everything on there, so many people, if everybody just kept it on and took a 30-minute shower, they would, you know, saving the water, so.
How are you getting, water? They have systems in the ship?
Yeah, they make their own water from the seawater. Mm-hmm. Yeah, they make their water. So that was something getting used to drinking that water, you know, because we not, it's soft, but or hard or whatever, but it was still
a different taste.
It was drinking. Yeah, it was a different taste.
And what about, because I know people talk, I've been on a cruise and you get seasickness.
Oh yeah, you do, but we didn't. I never got seasick out there. Now I have gotten seasick fishing on certain boats, but it was a different, but I never got. But I do know people have been seasick out there. You know, it happens.
What was the most memorable location in your service?
My most memorable place that I served in the Marine Corps was probably the Philippines, in barracks duty. I met some good friends there. I met one buddy there that we're still good friends right now. And I talked to him on his birthdays, and we stayed friends our whole time in the Marine Corps. And he was from St. Louis, Missouri.
Can you share his name?
Yeah, Fernando Lockhart.
Did you ever meet anyone that was from the same area as you by serving?
No, I never met anybody. I met some people that were from D.C. And that's what, when you're a country boy, you don't tell everybody you're from the country. You tell them you're from Washington, D.C. So I met some guys that were from D.C. and I still know some of them as well. Tony Moten, he was from Washington, D.C. But everybody. And matter of fact, a guy that worked with the District of Columbia Police Department, a friend of mine, George Ellis, I met him. I was driving the bus and I saw him, and he was a police and I'm driving the city bus, and I met him and we exchanged numbers. So you do see some people, you know, later on.
Why didn't you want to tell people, you know, you're a country boy?
I mean, you know, when you're a country boy and you got a country accent and people from the city, they kind of make a little fun of you. And, you know, you got that country accent or that swing. But I'm not ashamed of it now. I'm happy that I still hold on to it, because a lot of people didn't get what I got. They could be in the city, but they couldn't. I got an upbringing that was unreal, that they could never get. I was taught how to treat people and be self-sufficient. I know how to cook, clean, and do things in the yard. See, I can do it all. I can go inside, I can go outside, and I can teach them. And everything I was taught from the people that raised me in the country worked on to my job now. I help people like that, and I've always been helping people unconditionally. So the values and stuff that were instilled in me, that spilled on to the people, and I'm not ashamed of it anymore. I'm happy about it.
Did you ever see any type of combat?
I saw a little bit. We were in Beirut. I mean, the first time I received gunfire was in Grenada. And we were in a formation. We had to clear the island of the Cubans because they had taken over and killed the president. And we were going up to this old fort, and some people took a shot at us and we hit the duck. And that's my first sound of that cracking that you hear people in combat. You may not know it, but it sounds a lot like a person popping gum. You know how a girl used to be in your class maybe, and she could crack that gum? That's how that bullet sounds. And it's not a pleasant sound, especially when it's coming by your ear.
What year was that?
That happened in 81, beginning of 82.
What was the first thing to go through your mind when it finally registered, okay, I'm about to go into combat?
You always thinking about, the first thing that goes through your mind is, I want to get back home. I just want to be able to make it back home. Because you abroad, you don't know what to expect. I'll never forget the day that we went to Grenada. We was on the ship, and they was telling us of the conflict. We were on a ship headed to Beirut, but this conflict happened, so the ship made a turn and we went to Grenada. Now we are off of the coast of Grenada. We could see the lights, the island. We didn't know how far we were away. And what we went on was we were on a ship, I think it was called a LPH. It was a ship that had a well deck. It had a part in it. They could flood it. And they had these amphibious things. They looked like a tank, but the troops could fit inside of, we would sit in the back of there. And what it would do, it would be back here. They were on the side, and it would be back here. And it would float in the water, and it could go up to the land. So we sat inside of there, I'm going to say, getting ready to go to Grenada for about probably 12, 18 hours. And we sit in there, and then when you go, you will see the amphibious thing. It will be back here. It will take off. It will go real fast. And then this thing, you close the hatch, and when it goes and it dives. It dives down like that, and then it comes back up. Then they open the hatches and we start getting some fresh air. But it's scary because when it dives off, it's 20 of you all in there or more, and you in there with your combat gear, your helmet on tight. You don't know what to expect. And it was kind of scary, but all you're thinking about is completing your tour and getting home.
How many were on the ship total?
On the ship? On this ship? I'm not sure. Probably 400 or 500 people or more, at least. Because they had the Navy, then they had the Marine Corps. Probably about 500 on this ship. But I've been on ship that LPH with a couple of thousand. Yeah, so. Different ships have, because they're smaller, they require less people, and the bigger ships have more stuff going on.
Was there any other combat that you witnessed?
Well, Beirut was my most, that was more combat. That was actual firing a lot of rounds and doing a lot of stuff, and Beirut was the toughest place we had to go. Over there, I had some friends that were killed close to me. I probably could have been killed myself a few times, so I'm blessed to be here today. We got a lot of close rounds, a lot of that cracking going by your ear. We got into a lot of little skirmishes. The people you see in a day waving at you and hello, or shooting at you at night, so you don't know who your friend is. they had a experience, what I experienced, you know, you felt some relief. I'm gonna tell you what happened. The naval ships were in the water behind us in Beirut, and we went over there after the Lebanese people had, well, I don't know if it was Lebanese. Anyway, they bombed the building. It was a Marine Corps barracks that killed 300 and some Marines in this barracks. And we went over there and we went to relieve them. And we got out there, you know, we was around the airport. It was a perimeter around the airport. And we were around the airport and it was... I think about all of the, how we had to build it up. We got these old pipes and put across the top and we filled sandbags. That's what we did day and night, fortifying our position. So when we had to get into a skirmish, at least we would be covered or like that. And it was an experience you'll never forget. Really, it was.
How long did your did the combat in Beirut last?
We stayed there for about, we went in, that was maybe 81 or 82, and we stayed there for about 4 months. So 4 months worth before we finally pulled out, and it was a little rough.
Why was the U.S. involved in that conflict?
Well, you know, the U.S. get involved in a lot of things. They have interest in, you know, Lebanon, Israel is our ally. So if Israel's involved, we have to go along with them. And a lot of things over there we get involved into. We don't know everything about, a lot of it's a holy war they've been doing for years, so we can't win. Sometimes, a lot of times, it's not a winning situation. It's we're in a situation, and because we're there, we don't know all the logistics of it. All we know is we're trying to get back home. And you see people, when you hear, I've had a good experience I want to share with you, and this one was, I had some buddies in another platoon that got killed on top of this building. This building was in front of our perimeter that we had around the airport. We have observation posts so far out. And so far out in front of this building was an observation post. Now they have a bunker that they built up on top of the building, and in that building we would go up there and we would have night vision goggles, and we could tell the people back behind the friendly lines you know, what we see, what we observe, and if we had to fire positions or if we saw people moving. Now, these guys went up there and an artillery round hit the bunker, and I think it killed all of the guys that were there. Now, my fire team had to go up there after that had happened. And it wasn't pleasant, because when you go up there and you get to smell flesh and you never smelt it before, it sticks with you forever. We were up there on the building, and I was the observation post. They cleaned it up and built another bunker there, but we were still up there and you could smell the flesh. And I went up there with them, and I think this was maybe my second or third day up there. And how we get off was, we walk back and there's a ladder down the side of the building, and we catch the ladder down to the ground. Well, I start observing the artillery rounds, where they like walk in to you. They'll hit one over here, and then one over here, and then one over here. And that's what they did when they hit the bunker the first time. And I start observing the rounds coming over like that. And I called my lieutenant and I said, I believe they're walking the rounds into our position. And he said, hold your position. And as I'm noticing, the rounds are getting closer and they're getting closer. So I told my man to get off the building. And when I got to the top of the step, I'm the last one, and I'm going back. The artillery round hit the bunker, and it blew us off of the building on the ground, but we didn't die. And from that decision that I made, I got a meritorious mask. I don't have it with me, but it was for my job over there and putting the safety of my men before my own. And that's one thing I got that I'll never forget.
What was the fire team?
The fire team was four guys, and what you do, you work together. When they have different positions, you look out for each other. It's three fire teams in each squad, so it's 12 people in a squad. And the three fire team is like I said, it's three fire teams, and it's four people in each fire team. So we just have different positions. They name you and you get positions and they tell you what you need to do. And sometimes it works and then sometimes it doesn't.
Okay. One second.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
Okay. Going back to, I guess it's training.
Mm-hmm.
You mentioned jump school and rigor school.
Yes.
And I don't know what those are.
So well, jump school is, I went to Fort Benning, Georgia to jump school. And when I re-enlisted, I went to the school. And the school was, you're very privileged to be able to go to the school in the Marine Corps, because there's not many Marines that have jump wings. Jump wing, the Army has the 82nd Airborne. It's an airborne school. And it teaches you, you go there, and it's about a two-month training, and they train you pretty hard. And when you go there and you're a Marine, they give it to you bad, because they call you jarhead and all of this, and you have to do PT. It's not as intense as basic training, and then they teach you all the things to do, how the parachute fits, how you're gonna... They teach you how to hit the ground. They teach you how you gonna, and then they prepare you to fall. And so it's a lot of training, but it was good. And the motivation that I had in jump school, it was a Air Force lady that was in front of me, and I was tall. I was always a slim guy, but she was a little woman. And I said, if she do it, I'm gonna do it. And that was my motivation to do it. So I made it through. because she was my motivation. Now, this last part, this just fascinated me. At the end of jump school, they take the back off of the wing and they give you your blood wings. And you know, behind the back had a little sort of sticky thing, and they stick it in your shirt like that, and then they hit it in your chest like that. And she got her jump one, blood wing. I said, I gotta get mine too. So she brought me through that. She just don't know. She really did.
You remember now, her name?
I don't. Okay. I don't. Right. She was a little late. And then rigor school was a rigor packs the parachutes and prepares the chutes for other people to jump. And you have to go through a school. Now, I had prior training before I went to rigor school, so I knew I was going to come out number one in that class because I knew what to do. And I prided myself on doing it. I had a good teacher too. So, and I went to Fort Lee, Virginia, to that school, and then I ended up coming back, and they put that one there. I wasn't trying to pick recon. It was a amphibious unit that did like if when people went ashore. And I was supposed to be in that unit, but this other guy, he was married, and he didn't want to go to the recon, so that's how I kind of got designated, but it worked out for me.
So, and with the schools, do you ask to go?
Or well, when you re-enlist, and you're trying to get, you know, sometimes you re-enlist to get your bonus for re-enlisting or something, so, yeah, I think they gave me some money, and I might have bought a new car or something. And I re-enlisted and stayed in there for some more years. So it was a good career for me.
Did you actually ever have to jump?
Oh yeah, I made about 20 some jumps. I made quite a few jumps. Jumping was and you know, when you first do it in school, they take you on a plane, and then when you march down the hill in the morning. And you march down this hill, and it looks like the biggest plane you ever seen in your life. And it's a C-141. You march down there, and they put your parachute on, and then they put it on tight because it fits up in here and under here, and they put it on tight, and your reserve chute is in the front. And they put it on you tight, and then you get on the plane. Then the plane takes off. Well, the plane doesn't. People get on there, and you sitting on there and you nodding and people trying to play. So then they'll say 3 minutes, and how they wake the people up, they're sleeping. They'll say 3 minutes, 3 minutes, 3 minutes, 2 minutes. Then they say stand up, then you hook up. We're jumping from a static line. So it's hooked up to a cable that's connected inside of the plane. And the static line is hooked up to the main chute in your back. Once you jump out of the door, the parachutes comes out, and it's a line that's like a shoestring, and it's tied to the top of the chute, and it breaks away, and then the chute opens up. And when you first go and you see the green light, there's a stand in the door, and you stand in the door, then they hit you on your leg, go. And you go out, and you know, it's a shock when you jump out, and then that air hits you, and the chute come open, and then you see, wow, the chute is open. You look up there, and then it's smoke on the ground. So you have these little toggle knobs. You're supposed to pull them to turn yourself. So when you're going down, the air's at your back. When you come in, get ready to land, you turn, and they got smoke on the ground. So you turn to the smoke. So that you can come down. Now, once you get the civilian way is different. Once we get close to the ground's like, kind of, oh, I gotta remember what I gotta do. You hold your feet together and you hit your toes, your calf, right here, and you roll a certain way and you don't become injured. Now, I never became injured from it that I know of, but like I said, I got a few knee problems. But I always landed in the water. But I landed. I would get muddy. I get in the water every time. So it was a good experience.
How did you stay in touch with your family and friends back home?
You know, I wrote letters to my godmother that raised me. And I really didn't, you know, cell phones weren't plentiful like they are now. I mean, you would call every once in a while, but people wasn't going to accept a collect call from you and you away making money. And no, they wasn't doing that. You collect who? No, we didn't have that. And we didn't have cell phones. So we wrote letters. My godmother, I used to write her letters. And even when I went to Beirut, we was over there for the holidays and stuff. People used to send care packages, and these people would always send nice things to us. I mean, they would make homemade cookies. They would send you all kind of goodies and stuff that you couldn't get. And you was there for Thanksgiving, Christmas, New Year's, you know. So people made a difference. I had some people, I always think about these people. They were from Peoria, Illinois. It was a man and his wife. They were police officers in that city. And I always say I wouldn't mind going there one day, maybe try to find them. They're probably older now because I'm older. But and they had a daughter, and they sent me stuff. You know, they'll send you cheeses or if it's something you like. And we start writing letters back and forth. And I remember he was like 6'3" and she was 4'11". So, but I always remembered them, and they were from Peoria, Illinois.
So would, how was this experience of getting the care package? Would you share?
Everybody shared. We were glad to shoot. If we opened it, we had to eat it. So we were glad to share with our fellow troops, and it was a good experience.
Was it trading going on, or like my stuff coming from the south?
Oh, no, other people had other things that you wanted too. Right. So yeah, we do some trading, yeah.
Was there ever any time when you felt division between maybe races or sexes or anything like that?
No, I didn't see no races. I mean, oh, well, yeah, I have to take that back. The unit I was in, recon, it wasn't a lot of blacks in the unit. It was probably 5 out of 200 or 300. And a lot of the recon guys were guys that wore tattoos, chewed tobacco, and spit. And I could see that it was racism. You know, I recall going into the building, and one of them was spit tobacco on the ground. It wouldn't be right on you, but I mean, it would be over there or something. So I saw that firsthand, but that didn't keep me from doing what I had to do, my job.
What about women? Did you have come in contact with women?
Women that were in the service? No, not really. I mean, no, I didn't know any personally. I know when we were in basic training, once you got good and you was marching sharp and your unit was sharp and you get out there marching, and when we come up to a four-way stop sign, it would be WM Marines. They trained the women Marines too. And we couldn't look at them, they would tell. Because our drill instructor was tough. But some of them ain't want to look at them, no. Because they was rough. But it was, I seen them, but I really didn't know any first thing. But since I gotten out of Marine Corps, I know some family members of some people that went into the Marine Corps, women. And I don't care who goes in or what branch of service. I think it's good for all young people to go into the military. If you don't have any guidance or structure or no real purpose that you want to do, it will make such a difference in your life. I have a daughter. I wish she would have went to the Air Force, because I see her now reaching for straws. She don't have, she's very undisciplined. She doesn't have good structure. And you can tell her and teach her and talk to her, but she doesn't have what she could have had. And anybody that can go into the service, if it's a year or two, they will make a difference in your life.
Yeah, so I asked about the women. What about the gay community? Did you see or experience?
No. I didn't. I think that we had maybe one guy in our unit that was gay. But, you know, I don't have a problem with the gay community. I think the longer they keep their stuff to their business to themselves, because I've had coworkers at my job now, and they're just nice guys, and they do what they do with their people, and I don't have nothing against that, and I'm happy for them. So if that's what they do, you know, that's their business. I could see where society is making it more of acceptance. They want acceptance for it a whole lot. And, you know, people bashed it for so long. You know, it's easy to sit there and say something derogatory. But it's like they want acceptance more. I'm not going to say whether I agree with everything a whole lot, but it's like society is wanting acceptance a lot more.
But within the military and the don't ask, don't tell policy, mm-hmm. How did you see that play out?
Right now, well, then, I don't know if people knew it or did it or whatever, but now, I don't know. I have mixed feelings on it, one way or the other. I could say one way, because you got men in there, and should they have another bathroom that they should go to, then you don't want to be discriminating and saying that. So it's just like a football player on a football team. How do you deal with it? I mean, this is, and I understand they're professional, they're doing it a certain way, but that doesn't change the fact that they're still gay. So it could be, you could receive it a lot of different ways.
What'd you do for fun when you were off duty?
Did a lot of party. I did a lot of partying. We went out to clubs. We drank. Went to clubs mostly. You know, you wind down and we did some. I remember went to Haifa, Israel, and went on the tour of the greatest place I ever went in the world. I went to Haifa, Israel, and I went to Jerusalem. I was blessed to be on the Wailing Wall, the Mount of Olives, the River Jordan, these places, to see the people praying into the Wailing Wall, to sit on a camel's back on the Mount of Olives, to go in the streets where they slaughtering fresh meats and stuff. It was phenomenal. I felt it. Being there, that wow, you're in a biblical place, but I didn't take advantage of everything because I was a Marine. I was out there just having fun, and I wasn't thinking about all. I should have had more pictures of everything I did because I had a very good career, you know.
Where were you when you decided not to reenlist?
Well, I was messing up. That's why I never received a rank no higher than a corporal. I was ready to get a sergeant, and I had a bad habit. My bad habit was smoking marijuana. And when I first went into the Marine Corps, they didn't have a limitation on that. They didn't have that in place. And as I had been there and been smoking my little weed, the rule came in, and when a rule comes, it's hard to change. Some people think that they can beat it and do things, so that's why I didn't, once I got into, I got a little misdemeanor charge for some weed, and one of my units held it against me. It was something that happened out in town. I was in a car, and I was driving, and the police pulled me over, and I had a little bag, and I got a little minor offense, but it went back to them, and they used it against me. And I was using, so I made myself not excel as far as I could have, because I was undisciplined in that point. And even when I went to my job that I work now, that I just retired from, I was undisciplined. But I had to put that all aside because I had my eye on the prize, and that was reaching retirement yesterday. So,
woo-woo.
Yeah.
How did you return home?
I think I had a call. Matter of fact, I never came back home. What happened, when I got out of the Marine Corps in Jacksonville, North Carolina, I met this girl. And this girl and I met
her. What year was this?
This was in 1983. And I met her and her father, and they lived in Wilmington, North Carolina. And I went there, and I had been there a few times. How I met her was that friend of mine, where I'm still friends with since the Philippines, him and I are still friends. He went up there and he had met a young lady, and I remember him coming back to the base. I'm like, man, all his little St. Louis gold rings was gone, and his little chain, she took the player from him. So I went up and met this girl and said I was getting out. And you don't get many fathers. Her father let me stay in their house. But I got up in the Marine Corps at 12:30, and I was at work at 3:30. I got a job at the Budweiser Beer Company in Wilmington, North Carolina, right after I got out. And I've always had a job.
And then, so take us, so from Wilmington,
so from
D.C.,
from Wilmington, I stayed there. And then I started messing up, and I think I had a couple of accidents with the beer truck. Well, I worked in Wilmington in the warehouse, and then I worked my way up to getting a beer truck, driving a beer truck. Then they didn't give me the one I was supposed to get, the one that delivered the cases of beer. They gave me the keg because I was a big guy, and they figured, I guess they utilized my size. So. And what I did when I got that job, I tried to sell more kegs than anybody, and I set records that they would be hard for them to break. So when you get something, it's not always how you do it. It's you do it. I set records. I had people would buy from me when I wanted them just to make my records go higher. And then I left there after I stayed there for about 2 years, and my daughter was born right after that. I left and went to Washington, D.C., and I got a job at the moving company, and then I worked at a gas station, and then I put an application in for Metro Transit Authority, and I've been there for 27 years and freshly retired.
As of yesterday,
and I'm truly blessed. I don't have health issues. I don't have no problem. And I've had a good life.
How'd you readjust to civilian life?
Oh, it was easy to adjust to. I mean, you don't go out, people don't come out Rambo, you know. And a lot of guys think because they were in the Marine Corps that they are the toughest person out there. It's always somebody tougher than you. So you come out there as humble and do your job, and have you have to get a little action. Sometimes you may have to get some, but you try not to.
When you finally got back to D.C., how were you received by your family?
Oh, everybody was glad to see me when I got back. I didn't really, like I said, I never really came back home. I would always come to visit, you know, and everybody be glad to see you, and you be glad to see them. But sometime, a point in your life, you have to take charge and become your own individual. It ain't but three type of people in the world. It's people that wait for stuff to happen, it's people make stuff happen, and it's people don't know what's happening. So you have to do it. And that's what I've always did. And I'm not going to be rich, but I always saved a couple of nickels. And I can live and I can keep money in my pocket every day. And I can go wherever I want to go. And I don't have to depend on nobody. And the Marine Corps told me that.
I guess you already answered that question about remaining in contact. Well, how frequent do you remain in contact with some of the people you met in the Marines?
Not often, but I have a couple of buddies that email me, and maybe once or twice a year. I have one guy that lives close. He wants to watch football, so we'll do that this year. I could do more of the things I want to do now since I'm retired. But we'll remain. Matter of fact, he just asked me, did I want to go? They got a Beirut Memorial, I think it's in September. I'll probably get with him and we'll probably drive down there for that. And maybe meet some of the old Marine Corps buddies that I haven't seen. And I need to get me a Facebook page so I can really put myself out there and pull people. Because, you know, when you ain't on it, it's a good thing with Facebook. I don't like all that blogging. You know, where they're telling everything, I'm getting ready to eat and I'm going to, and all that. But I like it as far as where you can use it, where people say, oh, that's my man from over there. Yeah, so I like that part of it.
You remind me backtracking a little bit. How was the interaction between other branches, all the branches of the military, like in certain operations?
Oh, it was, you know, the Marine Corps and the Navy. The Marine Corps is a part of the Navy. It's a branch of the Navy. And that's how we go on the naval ships. Now, we're supposed to be the superior, but the Navy is tough too. And we had guys, we used to get to fighting and different things. And like I said, when we went to the Army guys always call you Jawhead and everything. But really, everybody respects everybody, and they know, we know what our jobs are. Our jobs are different, and some people have to get down and get dirty, and some people have to stay clean and do this. So that's the way it is.
Are you a member of any veterans organizations?
No, I probably will become. I'm going to get more involved since I'm freshly retired. I may get into a Veterans of Foreign Wars organization, and maybe I'm going to get more involved into the VA, and I need to go see them and fill out some paperwork for different things, but I'm gonna do some more things now that I'm retired.
How did the military life affect your life?
Oh, it affected my life greatly. It made me into the person I am today. It showed me discipline, and I use that discipline throughout my life. It made me be tenacious, and where I wanted to do something, to drive to do it. And it's been good to me, and that's why I say it would be good to anyone that was a young adult that don't have no guidance, that don't know what they want to do in life. It's better than being on a street corner. Is better than, and when you go apply for a job, people don't know. When you apply for a job, the person looks at you. If they look at you and they see that you've been in the service, they know you got some structure. First of all, you got some initiative because you've been taught. They will make you walk around in the mornings and pick up cigarette butts on the ground. And you couldn't imagine what's that building you for? That's building you for initiative. That right there, when you go around there, and I see people on my job, if you see some paper or something, you pick it up. Undisciplined people don't pick it up. They walk over, they throw it away, they leave it right there. So that's a learning thing there, and you would really be surprised.
What are some life lessons you've taken from the military?
Life lessons that I've taken from the service. I don't know, some of the stuff I just told you, just doing your job and being good at your job and helping others and be self-sufficient.
You're child of the civil rights movement?
I'm not sure.
I'm not sure. It was going on.
Yeah.
Were you aware of it? Did you participate? Or
no. No, I didn't really participate. Growing up on the farm, we didn't get into a lot of things. I do recall when Martin Luther King was killed. I remember the marches and the different things that people did, but we, you know, growing in the country, and we worked on farms with white people. We had, and you know, it's always a difference, but when I look at a person, I don't dwell on what has happened back in whatever time. Mm-hmm. I look at a person, and I've learned that from going around the world. I look at a person as a person, and I'm, you know, sometime I'll tell you, for example, I was on my bus. I used to drive the city bus, and one morning I was on the bus, and this guy was at the back of my bus, and he had been drinking. Normally, your first instinct would be, well, let's put him off the bus, get him off of here. So he said, bus driver, can I say something to you? I said, yeah. Can I say something to you? I said, yeah. He said, I lost my wife. He said, they had been married for 40 years, and I could understand. I said, well, you just sit on here and ride as long as you want. And so everything you think is bad, you can't always jump on it with all 4 feet. Because it may be a whole different situation. You could look at a person and say, wow, they ain't got nothing and they stinking and they die. But that person could have more money than you. So you can't, don't pass judgment on somebody just because. I had a buddy that just died March the 7th. He was 87 years old. Now I went to his house and I cooked for him. I gave him I took him liquor one after he had one, his wife and one daughter, and both of them died. One died 1 year, then the next year the other one died. Mm-hmm. And he was by himself, and he needed somebody. I would get him and come in there, and I'd take him over to your grandmother's house and cook fish for him. And I remember last year I took him fishing. We went, got on the boat, and we had to pick him up to put him on the boat, but he got on the boat. Now, when he died, I saw people, they was ready to grab everything he got. He said, I'm going to take care of you for the rest of your life. I said, don't worry about me. I'll be okay. And the guy said, well, I know he said he was going to do this. And I said, I'm not worried about what he said he was going to do. Because one thing I got from him, y'all could never get. I made him laugh. We had fun. And I loved him as a man. And he was 87, and right now I miss him so much because he was a vital part of my life. But he just taught me a lot, and I watched people come in. They took his car, they took this and that. That don't mean nothing because everything I got in here, they can't get.
What was his name?
William Gordon. Okay. William H. Gordon.
Good friend of mine. African American?
Yes, he was. Okay. Yeah.
And we didn't identify that you are the uncle of...
Yes, I am. I'm Earl Perry, and I'm his uncle. My baby sister's son.
What message would you like to leave for future generations that are here to see this interview?
If I could leave you with a message, is to have a goal in life. Try to make an accomplishment. I knew when I was growing up, I remember saying, I'm going to be a helicopter pilot. And I probably, if somebody would have been pushing me, probably could have been it. I ended up being a bus driver and a train operator, and I was a good one. I could tell the guy, I said, you know, when they would introduce the new classmates to me, I said, well, I'm not the best. I'm not the best here, but it's going to be hard to beat me. Because I'm good at what I do. Because when I did my job, I spoke with professionalism. I tried to treat people like I would be treated. And if you do those things in your life, treat people like you like to be treated. And sometime if you got, you might be a person like my daughter with a big mouth. And I tell her a lot of time, think before you open your mouth, because you may think back. See, once you say something, you can't go back and change it. So think before you open your mouth. But if somebody had to go through what I went through in my career, I think they would be happy. And the military is a good thing. That's all.
If there's anything you'd like to say to other veterans, what would it be?
I wish I could meet some of my old veterans that I haven't seen in years. I'm gonna try to get on that Facebook and make me a page and see what's up. And maybe I'll get some hits from some of my, but stay in touch with some of your buddies and remember the good times and the bad times, and it's gonna be okay.
Is there anything that you want to add that you feel like we didn't discuss?
No, I feel like you discussed everything, and I tried to give you the best answers that I could.
It's an hour and 10 minutes. You gave us a good one. Yeah. Do you happen to have, you mentioned you were writing. I'm just wondering, you wrote to your aunt, or you said your godmother?
Yeah, I don't have any of those letters. And then my godfather let some people come into the house, and a lot of things disappeared, so I'm not sure where all of that stuff.
But any photos from
them? I can find some photos.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So we would love to have some of those.
And I have some documentations of some, my paperwork, my ribbons and medals from the service. And
we'd love to see that.
My meritorious mass. I left out kind of rushing this morning.
And is that a...
this is Alexander the Great.
Oh, okay. I couldn't tell if it was...
Got that on a cruise. On a real cruise.
Real cruise, right. Yeah. Got to relax and get some, a little bit more space.
Yeah, a lot more space.
Right. Thank you so much.
Okay, you're welcome. All right, thank you. I hope I made y'all proud. Good structure. People raise me right.
Oh, you want to...
People can raise you, but you still have those rebels. Yeah. Don't listen.
That's right. Where's your restroom there?
It's right back here.
Okay.
There's no pictures, too.
Oh, yeah.
Right around here?
Oh, it's right there.
Right here.
Oh, okay.
Did you, when I post something, are we friends? I can't remember.
On LinkedIn?
Oh, yeah. No, on Facebook.
On Facebook? I don't think so.
Okay. Oh, sorry. It's out here. Oh, okay. What you gonna say? So I've posted Bonnie's.
Okay.
But I need to email you the actual image, so then you can post if you like.
Oh yeah, a few of the pictures too, from like the.
Yeah. From us standing up.
What time you? When will we need to meet for later?
Where will you? Cause I'll be leaving from here.
More than likely I'll be up. They're like having a meet and greet at the hotel right now. It's like it's. At the perimeter.
So probably best for you just to go, we'll just meet at his house.
Okay, that's fine.
Yeah, just go on. Because I don't know, I'm not as familiar out there, so I don't know what I don't even know of.